world's most wealthiest people, all of them accumulated their wealth and made their fortunes through stock market. Jeff Bezos owns 11% of all the shares of Amazon. Bill Gates owned 1% of all the shares of Microsoft. Warren Buffett, who we all know today as the world's greatest investor, owns 16% of all the shares of Berkshire Hathaway. If these people are able to create their fortune, become billionaires through stock market, then how is it that a small investor, more often than not, loses money and is not able to make it big? In some households, stock market is even called the den of gamblers. You can clearly counter me by saying that the examples of these wealthiest people is non-comparable because they own these businesses. Unlike you and me, they don't buy the stocks. Look, this is precisely where small investors go wrong. These wealthiest people own the same shares as you and me own, but their perspective of owning the share is not just to own the stock, but rather own the business. And all of these people did not create their wealth overnight, but consistently over long periods of time. According to the data published by Fidelity Investments, 80% of the retail investors lose money in stock market. And few of those who make it, most of them were lucky. And they actually do not know the process and temperament it takes to do it consistently over and over again. Prasenjit Paul, an investor who started from humble beginnings himself, in this book tells how a small investor who works in a full-time job and invests in stock market can avoid loss and earn consistently. This is the better investor, helping you achieve your financial goals and freedom through organizing your finance, stock market investing, and learning from billionaires. And these are top 5 lessons from the book, How to Avoid Loss and Earn Consistently in Stock Market by Prasenjit Paul. Lesson number 1. The trap of trading. The very first thing that attracts retailers is trading. And this boast of unimaginable profits of doubling money in 3 months, 50% return every week, earning 10,000 rupees daily through trading. Those who attract them are these trading gurus, fee-based trading tip providers. For a beginner, the scheme of profit look good and very attractive. Most of these tip providers also give 100% guarantee of correctness of the trading tip. You really have to be a fool to believe that. If they could, with 100% guarantee, generate profit worth 50% every week, then why are they in the business of selling tips? Should they not take as much loan from the bank as they could, become billionaires in 1 year, return their loan and sip martini on the beach? Why is it that we have never heard of a trading guru in the Forbes wealthiest people on the earth? Isn't that fishy? These are scammers. They will offer you 5-day free trial. To your surprise, their tips will work all 5 days. Wait, what? They're able to give correct tips all 5 days? Now you may ask me, if all of this is scam, then how is it possible to give someone 100% accurate trading tip in the trial period and that too for 5 continuous days? Isn't that impossible? This is very simple to understand. Let me explain you how. These trading tip providers buy customer database, which have your number and email. Let's say they have emails of 5,000 such people and they are finally able to make 1,000 of these people agree to take their free trial. The trading guru will divide these people in 2 groups of 500 each. On the first day to the first group, the trading guru will tell to buy the stock of Amazon that it will go up. And to the second group, he would tell to sell the stock of Amazon because it is going to go down. Obviously, one of the group would be in profit because on any given day, either the stock goes up or it goes down. So one of the group has to be correct and the other wrong. Now the trading guru will not contact the group who went wrong. He will not be available to take the calls. To the group of 500 people who made profits, he would again divide them in 2 groups of 250 each. He would again tell one group to buy Amazon stock because it is going to go up. And to other group, he would tell to sell the Amazon stock because it is going to go down. Again, the same thing happens. One group has to be right. He would repeat the process again and again till the last day, when the group of 62 winners from the fourth day are divided into group of 31 each. One group of 31 people finally is able to make money on all 5 days. They are ultra optimistic now and are ready to pay $5,000 for these 100% accurate tips. But obviously, these people are not going to get correct tip always now, because market is always uncertain. Nothing is ever 100%. And it is now that after 5 correct calls, retailers will invest big sum of money and finally burn a hole in their pockets. By these 31 people, the trading guru has already earned more than $150,000. The only person who has guaranteed 100% made profits from this is the trading guru himself, and not you. Trading is a full-time activity. It involves a lot more things, a lot more knowledge of macroeconomics than just a trend line and few patterns that these trading gurus tell you about. Be skeptical of scammers selling you dreams of unimaginable profits. They may not be the path to wealth, but are surely the path to wealth erosion. Lesson number 2. Return on equity. Suppose you choose a company or someone tells you to invest in it. The very first thing people generally would jump in to see is what are the profits of the company, or the growth in profit in last few years, and how much is the sales number? But Prasenjit says that is wrong approach to take. The so-called profit number can very easily be manipulated by the company on the financial report, since the managers know that most investors in stock market run behind profits of the company. So it is in interest of company's management to keep reporting repeated growth in profits. So investors invest in the company, pushing the stock price higher. In short term, the debt can also fuel up the net profits. Not only that, the net profit that we see on the income statement does not tell us anything about how much cash finally went to company's bank account after paying for all the cash expenses. Many a times, company will report net profit. However, when you see the cash flow statement, you will realize that cash has actually reduced from company's bank account. For this purpose, profits are not the first thing you must see. Prasenjit explains the first thing you must see when you look at the company is return on equity. Equity means the shareholders' investment in the company. So return on equity is nothing but return on shareholders' investment. Let us compare two ice cream parlor companies. One, the Italian ice cream company, and the other, the Belgian ice cream company. Italian ice cream company has 5 stores in your city, while the Belgian ice cream company has 20. Italian ice cream company makes $30 profit from $100 investment. And the Belgian ice cream company makes $200 profit on $1,000 investment. Then the return on investment of Italian ice cream company is 30%, and that of Belgian ice cream company is 20%. Italian ice cream company is more efficient. If Italian ice cream company invests $1,000 like Belgian ice cream company, then they can make $300 profit. The net profit of Belgian ice cream company is big, but Italian ice cream company is more efficient. So return on equity tells us about the efficiency of the business, and this can be found out about any company online on Google. The higher the return on equity of the company, the more efficient it is. As an investor, you would invest your money in an efficient business rather than the big business which is inefficient. Though no single ratio should be seen in isolation, but as a rule of thumb, considering all other parameters equal for comparison, a company with return on equity less than 10 is poor. Between 10 to 15 is average, more than 15 is good, and more than 20 is exceptional. Lesson number 3. The competitive advantage. Investment decisions should not only be based on numbers. Don't assume that an extremely profitable company will maintain its profitability in future too. High growth in any business attracts competitors. For example, in India, telecom service was a very high growth business. Apart from state-owned BSNL and MTNL, there were hardly any competitors. they were minting huge profits. This attracted attention of many other private players. You would be surprised to know that by 2012, there were more than 30 telecom providers in India. Aircel, Arcom, Airtel, Vodafone, Uninor, Dutch, to name a few. Now, after almost 10 years, most of them have gone bankrupt and do not exist. The most profitable business of MTNL and BSNL today are struggling to even pay their employees. From more than 30, there are just 4 telecom players left. World's greatest investor Warren Buffett said, "In business, I look for economic castles protected by unbreachable moats." Moats were big dugouts built around a castle so that any enemy could not enter the castle. Now let's have a look how companies create economic moat. The most common way is to offer better product or service than its competitors. Customers don't hesitate to pay a little more for a better product. Differentiating factors may be technology, durability, appearance, and over a long period of time, the brand. Apple is the simplest example of it. Apple is able to sell a phone for much premium than its other competitors, even with same specifications. There are many chocolate brands, but Cadbury is the outright winner because of its economic moat. Every year, it reduces the volume of the chocolate. If you were paying 10 rupees for 200 gram chocolate, then next year, they would reduce the size of the packaging and you would be able to get just 160 grams for 10 rupees. And even after all this, the sales just keep on going up, because customers are fan of their taste and the brand. One of the other factors for this can also be high switching cost. Suppose you buy a car. Now for the next 10 years, you would get your servicing done for the same car from the same car company. It is not so easy to keep changing cars like you can change your lipstick. If you open your bank account in a bank, then to open your deposit account in some other bank, you need a lot of paperwork, which customers generally don't want to do, unless the service is very poor. Networking effect can be other reason. If all your friends are on WhatsApp, but for whatever reason you like Telegram, then you just cannot go there because all your friends are on WhatsApp. You would just be sending your selfies to yourself if you are the only one out there on Telegram. That is why you are forced to use WhatsApp in this case. It is very difficult to find such businesses, and finding a business with an economic moat is completely subjective and depends on your knowledge of the product, customer base, and analysis rather than numbers. However, return on equity and operating profit margins are the two numbers that can give you an approximation of the economic moat of the company. Nike, a well-known shoe brand, has return on equity of 30%, whereas that of Red Tape is 10%. This can clearly tell you the difference and where the economic moat is. To pull out one more example, return on equity of Apple is 73% and its operating profit margins are 30%, whereas that of Samsung is 12% and operating profit margin of 14%. Which business has an economic moat? It is evident to you.
Lesson number 4. Debt. The dangerous four-letter word. All of us opt for various type of loans during different stages of life. Home loan makes it affordable to buy our dream house. Car loan fulfills our goal of owning a car. Borrowing is neither good nor bad. It depends on the financial profile of the borrower. Similarly, debt, the four-letter word, is essential for business for their expansion and operational requirements. Debt for business can help boost profits. However, excessive debt coupled with bad management at bad times can lead to bankruptcy. As a small investor, a simple ratio called debt to equity ratio can tell you from far whether the company's debt is low or high. Debt to equity ratio is the ratio of all the borrowings of the company and shareholders' investment. If debt to equity ratio of any company is more than 1 and increasing, it should definitely ring an alarm bell. Just like return on equity, debt to equity ratio is also available on Google. It must be seen for past few years to see what the trend is. A debt to equity ratio of less than 1 or decreasing is a positive sign. Just for an anomaly, all the lending businesses such as banks and non-banking finance companies have debt to equity ratio much more than 1. Because the business is based on borrowing money at lower interest rate and then lending that money at higher interest rate. Lesson number 5. Stocks to avoid. Charlie Munger, the right-hand man of Warren Buffett, who is currently 97 years old and known for his words of wisdom, said, "All I want to know is where I'm going to die, so that I don't go there." Thus, it is prudent to know in stock market the stocks that you must avoid at all costs. These are high debt companies. The easiest way to find them is by looking at the debt to equity ratio mentioned above. During good times, the bad managers of the company become over optimistic and fund the growth with huge debt. When the cycle turns, the debt becomes unmanageable. The business along the stock price then suffer. Second, low promoter holding. A company in which the owners of the company do not have a majority stake, which is called skin in the game, you must avoid it. If the company has low promoter holding, that does not mean it will do bad. But in the company where promoter hold big stake, that means that the wealth of the owner is directly dependent on the functioning of a business. Like a small investor, the owner of the company cannot enter or exit into the stock of the business with a click of a mouse. There are legal filings which happen if owner wants to sell or buy their stake. Shareholding pattern of all the companies are updated quarterly, and increasing promoter holding is a good sign, and consistently decrease in promoter holding should make you alert. Stay away from small companies where promoter holding is less than 20%. Third, high promoter pledging. The owners of the company can keep their stake in the company as collateral and avail loans from the bank. This activity is called pledging of shares. Sometimes this loan can be for operation of business. However, sometimes the loan can be for personal reasons as well. Pledging is generally the last resort for promoters to avail the loan. If the promoters are not able to meet the obligations of loan in time, then banks have the right to acquire shares of the promoters and sell it in stock market to convert it into cash. The excessive selling of stocks can further hit the stock price. Prasanjit says that as a conservative small investor, it is better to avoid these stocks completely. Fourth, stock touching new lows. Unless and until you are confident about prospects of the business, avoid stocks which are touching new lows year after year. This can be a red signal. This will soon be indicated by bad fundamental ratios and bad numbers of the company. If you have in-depth knowledge about the business of the company and are sure that everything is good, then these can be opportunities of outsized returns. But more often than not, most of the stocks like these are graveyards for investors who are lured by the word outsized returns. Fifth, too much popular stock. When the stock becomes too popular and everyone buys it, it becomes overpriced and gets very risky for our hard-earned investment. When everyone talks about investing in Tesla, doubling their money in tech companies, stay away. The most popular an investing instrument becomes, the more likely it is to underperform in long term. Tech companies at the peak of 2000 dot-com bubble, real estate company at the peak of 2008, to pull out a few examples of such kind. Sixth, the costly acquisition. To scale up business to achieve faster growth rate, many companies opt for costly acquisitions. Many times, costly acquisitions with external debt and inability to turn around the company to profits causes enormous wealth destruction. Sri Renuka Sugars, a sugar company, acquired two Brazilian large sugar manufacturing loss-making plants in 2010. The acquisition increased their debt 5 times in 2 years. The stock price of Sri Renuka Sugars in 2010 was 120 Indian rupee. Today, after more than 10 years of acquisition and inability of company to turn the Brazilian plants into profit, the stock price of Sri Renuka Sugars today is just 12 Indian rupee. Capital erosion of more than 95%. Let's have a quick recap.
The first step to avoid loss as a small investor is to stay away from trading. Trading is a full-time job and needs enormous knowledge of macroeconomics, information about business that everyone does not know. Be aware of the trading gurus and stock tip providers who promise you 100% guaranteed returns of unimaginable profits. Profits and sales number of the company can be easily manipulated. However, what cannot be manipulated is the cash in bank. The first thing that an investor must look at in a company is its return on equity. It is the ratio that tells about the efficiency of business. Keeping all things same, return on equity less than 12 is poor, 12 to 15 is average, more than 15 is good, and more than 20 is exceptional. Look at the return on equity data for past few years. Economic moat is the competitive advantage that a business has, which gives the business an edge over its competitors. This may be due to better product, technology, brand, networking effect, etc. An economic moat is completely subjective, but some indicators of it can be high return on equity and high operating profit margins. Buying a business with economic moat is a big protection to downside risk. Debt is the most dangerous four-letter word. Unmanageable debt can bankrupt a company. Debt-to-equity ratio is a good indicator of the borrowing position of the company. Debt-to-equity ratio of more than 1 and increasing is a serious red flag. Small investors must avoid stocks which have high debt, low promoter holdings, company where the owners of the company have pledged the share, company which is hitting all-time lows, the most popular stock that every news channel, your friend and taxi driver is talking about, and last but not the least, the stock of the company that makes costly acquisitions. That's it guys. If you like the video, don't forget to like and subscribe. You can check out my lessons from Benjamin Graham's Intelligent Investor 2. I will come again with a summary and lessons from the new book on investing or finance soon. Until then,